The recent God of War video game is one of my favorite video games of all time. And since it won Game of the Year, I assume many of you enjoyed it as much as I did. But there's one thing you may be wondering. What happened before the game? What happened to the mother? What happened to Kratos? And what happened to Boy? Well, today we're going to be covering the Titan Comics storyline, God of War 1 through 4, explaining just a little bit of what happened beforehand to the Boy. This is the Complete Story series, where we take some of your favorite pop culture icons from comic books to video games to movies, and we break them down into digestible bites to allow you to understand. We then read them dramatically back to you, giving you a bit of an audio narrative where we voice out characters and we add in some epic music. Enjoy the ride, and if you want to talk to me directly about the God of War, or the Boy, or the Power of the Beard, join me at twitch.tv/eligiblemonster, where currently I am streaming a video game, most likely Final Fantasy. Let's get to that story, Boy! As the peaceful quiet falls over the snowy home, the young boy Atreus plays just outside when he hears a knock coming from the woods. He looks up to see his father, Kratos, standing over him asking, "Where is your mother?" Atreus tells him that she left while he was asleep, said that she'd be back by nightfall. Kratos then asks, "Was there anything else she may have said?" And Atreus says, "Well, she did say that there was some wood that needed to be chopped." Kratos walks over to the pile of logs, grabs an axe, stating that he thought as much. It might be time for him to pull his weight. Now get to it. He slams the axe down, lodging the axe into one of the thicker pieces of wood, telling Atreus not to disappoint him. As Kratos begins to leave, Atreus asks, "Are you going into the woods to test yourself again?" Kratos looks back, "Yes, though it would seem that today's test has already begun." He heads deep into the forest, crushing the undisturbed snow beneath his feet, thinking to himself that he must test himself each and every day. He must find a worthy challenge. Just then a deer looks up startled and Kratos asks, "What is you spooked?" "Ah." Across the way, a pack of wolves bare their teeth as they growl. Kratos says, "Yes, this is the challenge that I seek. This is the test. I must keep my rage under control, face danger, and choose not to fight. Prove myself better than those mindless trolls who savaged these wolves' mates not long ago. I control my rage." He pauses for a moment and then turns, stating, "Not today. My rage does not control me." As the sun begins to set, Kratos starts to walk back towards his cottage when he hears the deep growls of a beast in the distance. He looks over to see a bear mauling a man as the man shouts in a different language. Could this be the challenge that he seeks? The bear pins the man down as the blood drips from his free paw, and all Kratos does is watch. He cannot understand the old man's cries, but clearly he screams in fear. He should walk away. What is the fate of one old man to him? He does turn, and then he feels it. The rage inside beginning to swell. The demon of fury struggling to break free. Kratos clenches his fists, telling himself, "No, I will control my rage." Despite his best efforts, though, he grinds his teeth and he shouts as he leaps into the air. He comes down throwing the bear off of the old man, and as that bear roars, Kratos roars back. The bear lashes out to try and bite down on any part of Kratos that it can find, and he reaches out stating, damn you to hell. He pulls his arm back, ripping the jaw off of the bear, letting it bleed out into the white snow. He looks back at the old man as he tries to say something, but his wounds are too grave. And he passes on to the next life. Kratos catches his breath and he quietly says, "Damn you both to hell. Damn the old man for arousing my sympathy, and damn that bear for stroking the fires of my rage, and damn myself for losing control again. I will rest and I will test myself tomorrow." As Kratos passes through the mountain barrier protecting his home, men in the distance watch intently, all speaking the same language as that old man. When Kratos arrives at the cottage, he looks at the pile of logs, still unchanged from when he left, and he silently groans. Close by, Atreus looks up with his figures, stating, "Oh, I was about to start chopping, honest. So how did it go? Did you pass your..." Kratos tells him, "That is enough. Has your mother returned yet?" And Atreus tells him, "No, sir." Kratos opens the door to their home, telling him that he best chop some wood for the fire. And quickly, when she returns, perhaps I will. But just then there's a loud snap, and Kratos' eyes immediately look towards the gate. The men watching Kratos from before begin to walk forward, and Kratos asks, "Who are you and why have you come? Leave this place." The large men begin to yell at him in the same tongue as the old man from before, and Kratos tells them that their words mean nothing to him. Atreus whispers that they said that he killed their brother today and they have come for revenge. Kratos then says that he killed no man's brother today, just a mindless beast. The men begin to shout and Kratos readies himself in a fighting position. And as the men go on, their words become twisted and their bodies begin to change into giant bears, just like the one from earlier. Kratos launches himself into one of the bears, calling out to Atreus to get to safety. Atreus asks, but where should he? Oh, he looks up to see one of the bears towering over him and he calls to his father for help. Kratos stops his fighting, seeing his son in danger, shouting, "Enough!" He wraps his arm around the bear, locking his hands together, squeezing, until he hears a loud crack, with the bear's spine snapping. As the body falls lifelessly, Kratos charges into the bear, getting ready to strike Atreus. His body is flung to the side of the woodpile, but before he can get back up, the bear slashes at his back. He yells out in pain, but before he can get to his feet, the bear pins him down, tearing away at his back again. Through the dirt in his mouth, Kratos quietly says, "Damn you," and then he sees the axe still lodged in the pile of logs. He reaches out, grabbing it by the handle, whipping his arm back, and with a loud thunk, the blade of the axe slams into the skull of the bear and it stumbles back. It falls to the ground with Atreus stating, "I'm sorry, I tried to." But before he could finish, the old man begins to shout something at the two of them. Kratos asks, "What did he say?" And Atreus tells him, "He says that you're gonna have to pay for spilling the blood of his brothers and that he will return with the rest of his clan." Kratos pulls the axe out, telling him, "No, he will not. There's no time to retrieve a proper weapon, so this will have to do. Come on, boy!" As Atreus follows closely behind, he asks, "Wouldn't I be safer at home?" And Kratos tells him, "Not if we lose his trail and they return while I'm away." Atreus then says that he's scared, and Kratos turns back telling him, "You must learn to control your emotions. Until we have dealt with anyone who knows the way to our home, the safest place for you is by my side, boy." Kratos looks back onwards towards the woods. And as the snow settles, covering the old man's trail, his frustration begins to set in. The fires of his rage begin to burn brighter to the point of consuming him. These beastmen invaded his home. They threatened his family. Mindless beasts seeking only revenge. And then their leader flees into the night like a coward. He will hunt them down to the ends of the earth. Him and the rest of his kin. He will wring the life out of them with his bare hands. Bathe them in their blood. He will have his revenge for. Atreus asks, "What do we do?" And suddenly, the rage fades. No succumbing to the bloodlust, seeking only revenge. That is their way, not his. I will control my rage. It does not control me. As the calmness washes over, Kratos says that he will keep looking until they find him. Atreus begins to think for a moment and then says, "Actually, maybe Vala will know where he is. The old seer lives down in the valley. Maybe she knows something about the beastmen. Mother sometimes visits her hut. She took him there once when he was a child." Kratos looks back and Atreus quietly says, "Well, it's just an idea." Kratos turns forward telling him,
"It is a good idea. I've always steered clear of the old hag, but your mother values her counsel."
Atreus takes the lead, showing Kratos the way, but as Kratos watches, he thinks to himself that the boy is soft, weak, defenseless, unfit to face the challenges of the world. The day will come when he will need to stand on his own. As the two travel through the night, the sun rises and Atreus points out to the horizon. "There it is." Kratos walks up to the small hut, telling Atreus to wait outside. He will not enter until they know that it is safe for him. He cautiously walks in and he examines the surroundings. An old haggard voice calls out to him that he can enter freely. He is welcome here. Kratos asks the voice, how does she know him and how does she know his tongue well enough to speak it? The voice tells him that's because she is the seer. It is her calling to know things, and she knows great many things. She knows that he is Kratos, Godslayer, and the pass from which he runs. She knows the secrets of the beastmen whom he seeks as well. Fire and death lay along the path on which he walks, and bloody-handed he will follow that path to its end. Kratos tells the seer, "No more riddles. Tell me what you know of these beastmen, and speak plainly."
She holds out her hand, telling him that he must stifle the flames of his rage if he is to comprehend Godslayer. He must control himself, for whom he seeks is known as the Berserkers. They are both at the same time more than man and less than human. Once the scourge of this land, now only a handful remain, and though their flames may not burn as brightly, their fires have not yet gone out. The Berserkers draw their strength and power from the animal spirits which they enshrine in a totem that they worship as a god. They pray to their self-made god to strengthen the arm and stiffen the sinew, pledging blood and fealty in return. The Berserker's rage fuels his faith, and if he is found worthy, his body twists into a physical manifestation of that rage. Their numbers lessen with each passing generation, but she has seen in the flames they will soon be gone from the face of the earth. Kratos asks, "This totem is the source of their power." And the seer tells him that it is the focus, but not the source. They derive their strength from the bear god that they revere, but it is the power of their own rage which allows them to tap into that strength. Their fury, which burns inside of them, gives them power, but robs them of their ability to reason. They do not act out of wisdom, but out of fury, which means that they often make foolish choices. Something that she thinks he understands better than anyone. Kratos' eyes widen at the seer's words. He lets them go unchallenged. The simmering anger that he feels on hearing them is proof that she speaks truth. Too often has he let his rage guide his actions, regardless of the consequence. However, he is no mindless beast like the thrice-cursed Berserkers. "I often control my rage. It does not control me." He then asks, "Where is the bear god totem?" She tells him that there is a ritual that she could perform, but if she begins it now, she will have the answer by sunrise. But the ritual is not easy. The answer that he seeks will come at the price, Godslayer. Kratos asks, "What is the price?" And the seer says, "One that he must pay when the time comes." He scoffs, "Very well, work your magics, hag. I shall wait outside." As time passes, Kratos sharpens his woodcutting axe until the seer steps into the light, stating that she has the answer. He will find them in a longhouse to the north of here, destroy the totem, and rob the Berserkers of their monstrous strength and deal with them as men. Be mindful that he faced them as a man himself, one capable of reason and wisdom. If he fights the monsters on their terms, he will surely lose. He dresses himself, then Atreus picks up the axe, asking, "Shall I go as well?" Kratos quickly grabs the axe from his hands, telling him, "You are going nowhere, boy. I will not put you into harm's way again. You are not ready to follow the path that I walk. Stay here and stay safe with the seer. Soon you will be back by your mother's side." Atreus sighs, looking at the ground.
Yes, father.
And Kratos travels a day's journey to the north, and as the sun lowers, he finds the longhouse the seer spoke of. He sneaks in to find the Berserkers asleep around their bear god totem. He tightens his grip on the axe as he quietly makes his way in, being mindful to not disturb the beastmen. It would be so easy for him to strike them as they slept, but if only one of them were to wake in that time and call upon their bear god, it might be too late. With each passing second, Kratos gets closer and closer to the totem, and just as it's within arm's reach, a voice calls out to him. He looks back to see one of the Berserkers calling out to the others, and he tells them to stay their claws. They have violated the sanctity of his home, and he has come to put an end to this. Step aside, and they shall live, or stand against him and die. The choice is theirs. Either way, he will destroy that totem. All of the Berserkers begin to get up, shouting, and as they do, each of them turn into a giant, snarling bear. Kratos clutches his axe, throwing himself into battle, stating, "Damn you! Damn you all to hell!" The flames within Kratos burn white hot, and he is consumed. He is fury. He is rage. One of the Berserkers knocks Kratos' axe out of his hand, but Kratos charges in, wrapping his arms around the Berserker. He struggles to break free, but Kratos headbutts and thrusts his arm into the Berserker's stomach. As a loud crack, as the Berserker's spine snaps, and Kratos throws the body down, shouting, "Die!" He spins back, grabbing the axe, hacking away into the next Berserker. But one careless swing gives the Berserker the time to knock him down. The Berserker pins Kratos to the ground, opening its mouth, getting ready to bite down. But before it can, Kratos whips his arm up, lodging the axe deep into the forehead. As the giant lifeless body falls to the ground, he gets up, pulling out his axe, asking, "Who's next?" The Berserkers howl, they roar, and Kratos yells back, "If that's what you want, come at me!" Blood splatter begins to paint the walls of the Berserker's cabin as Kratos continues to fell one beast after another. But as he is hit, he remembers what the seer told him. If he is to fight the monsters on their own terms, he will surely lose. He must face them as a man himself, one capable of reason and wisdom. He closes his eyes, telling himself, "Yes, the old woman was right. I must fight as a man, not as a monster. My rage does not control me."
He takes a deep breath, turning, throwing his axe into the berserker's totem. A loud thock echoes throughout the cabin as everything stops and the totem slowly ignites. The flames quickly turn the carving into ash, and when Kratos looks back, the berserker holding him down reverts into a man. The berserkers look around for answers, speaking to each other in their native tongue, but Kratos pushes them off. He tells them, "You violated the sanctity of my home. You threatened my family. No more." Moments pass as he steps out of the burning cabin, stating that it is done. With the totem destroyed, the berserkers pose a little threat. He may have let them live, but the demon within him took hold. "Damn them for forcing my hand. And damn me for not being strong enough to resist it." He takes the last torch, tossing it on the cabin, and he leaves. Back at the seer's hut, the seer tells Atreus that his father will be coming back soon. But there is something that he must do for her before he returns. She hands him a small dagger, telling him that when the time comes, remember this moment, and know that he will be stronger than he ever knows. Atreus takes the dagger, asking, "What does that mean? What am I supposed to do?" A snapping of twigs can be heard, and the seer tells him that there is no time to explain. He is already here. Just then, the elder berserker pulls open the hut flap, shouting in their language. Atreus puts himself between the man and the seer, stating, "Don't worry, wise one, I'll protect you." And a few moments later outside, Kratos climbs up the cliff, seeing the hut, thinking that by morning the boy will be back by his mother's side. Then he can test himself again in the woods. But as Kratos finishes the climb, a scream can be heard, and he runs in yelling to Atreus, asking if he is hurt. Atreus stands holding the bloody dagger, telling the berserker to step away. With Kratos shouting to Atreus, telling him to run while he handles this, the berserker yells and Kratos shouts, "For the last time, I do not understand your gabbing!" As the berserker throws himself forward, Kratos grabs the berserker by the head, pushing back, creating a loud snap. The berserker falls to the ground with his head twisted and lifeless, and Kratos looks at the wounded seer, asking if she saw this coming. She tells him that she said before that there would be a price for him to pay. He defeated the last of the beastmen, but there is an enemy that he is yet to conquer. Himself. She draws her last breath and then leans back. Kratos steps out of the hut, telling Atreus that they're going to need to build a funeral pyre. As the flames burn, Kratos thinks to himself that the boy put up a spirited defense before his arrival. There is hope for him yet. Kratos begins to walk, stating that it is time for them to return home, and Atreus asks, "Did I do well?" Kratos continues his pace, telling him, "You did well enough. From this point on, leave the fighting to me." Atreus hurries to catch up, stating,
Yes, father.
As Kratos finishes telling himself that even though there's hope for the boy, he will see to it that he does not follow the same path as his father.
I hope you enjoyed this storyline, and I need all of you to do something epic, truly epic. Hit up Titans Comics and tell them, "We want more Kratos. Give us more of this comic. Give us more of God of War. By the power of the beard, Kratos will live on."
If you want to talk about video games and stuff or enjoy what we do here, then please consider subscribing to Comic Story Game, as we not only do video game recaps and the comic books and their storylines, but we actually do superhero books like Batman, Superman, and stuff like that. Coming up soon in our video game coverage, we'll be doing more Warframe lore and some of the Witcher comics. And I think Anthem's got a comic, but we might not cover it since like no one is apparently playing that game. I don't know. Either way, join me over at twitch.tv/eligiblemonster if you want to just kind of hang out and play video games with me, or you could join us over at our gaming channel, Eligible Monster, where we bring you gaming discussions about the current news, stuff that's happening, and just kind of make fun of a lot of fun stuff that's happening. Me, Dan, and Natalie. Either way, guys, thank you so much for joining us today. I hope you enjoyed this. This is the only God of War comic right now. So it's time for us to cover what happened in the game, what happened in the original series of games, and other video game comic books. So make sure you do subscribe, make sure you follow me on Twitter. And I'm rambling now, so just, how's your day? Who's got a better beard, me or Kratos? It's me or Kratos, what do you think? Think I can get to this? I want that. That's what I'm after right now, and when I do it, shaving the head, tattooing the eye. That's what I'm doing. Let me know if you think that'll look good. In all honesty, I got a feeling a lot of you are gonna say yes, not because it'll look good, you just wanna see if I'll do it.